Good morning. How are you today? It is April the 2nd. We're in a new month, and this is a great month. One, it's rodeo month, all right? Got kicked off with Big Hat Day yesterday, all right? Most important this year, it is Easter month. And that is absolutely exciting. So what a great month and what a beautiful day for us to share. 8 o'clock service was packed. All right, we had to pull chairs in for 8 o'clock service. That doesn't happen often, all right? So that was terrific. So, but good to see you all out today. If you are a guest at New Hope, you honor us with your presence today. Thank you so very much for coming. There's a communication card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill it out and drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. And next week, through the mail, we'll send you information about New Hope. Tells you what we believe, who's on our staff, the ways you can engage if you choose to. We make a promise. We will not beat on your door. We will not bother you on the phone. We will do this strictly through the mail and let you know what we hope would be the most important things you want to discover about New Hope Church. So I hope you'll do that. Those cards are also for our church family, messages to the staff, prayer requests, those kind of things. Please take advantage of those, and we'll get through those as soon as we possibly can. Yesterday was what? April Fool's Day. How many of you got fooled at one moment or another? Okay, all right, got a few hands going. How many of you tried to fool somebody yesterday on April Fool's? Okay, got a few other hands going up. I had the privilege of doing a wedding yesterday afternoon. Okay, it's only the second time I've ever done a wedding on April Fool's Day. The first time I did one, it was planned. I mean, it was a Wednesday evening, all right? So you know they were trying to make it fit. And actually, it was pretty cool. They had invited several friends to their house for a backyard barbecue on April Fool's Day, all right? They didn't tell them they were coming to the wedding. So there's about 40 people here at this backyard barbecue on a Wednesday night for April Fool's Day, and I show up, okay? And some of the folks knew me, some didn't, but, you know, those who didn't know me say, Tim, didn't know you knew this couple. What are you doing? I said, man, barbecue. And, you know, I'm here. And so we let that go for about 20 minutes, and then the couple disappeared and went in, and I stepped kind of to a platform area. And I said, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to invite all of you to come have a seat. Bring your chairs up. I said, but here's what I want you to do. As you bring your chairs up, I want you to leave me a center aisle. And they're looking, what are you? I said, because the fool's on you. You thought you came for a barbecue, but you're here for a wedding. Woo! Did the screams go up, man? And we had a wedding. Well, I did the opposite yesterday. At the end of the wedding, I told the bride and the groom and all the guests, I said, now y'all thought you came here for a wedding? But I said, this isn't legal. This is April Fool's Day. I said, I've torn up the marriage certificate. So anyway, then I got to say April Fools to them. All right, so, but that was fun. That was fun. Hey, I'm glad you're here. What an incredible weekend for our valley. Actually, it started last weekend and it culminates this afternoon and tonight. As many of you know, Luis Palau and the Fresno City Fest is going on. How many of you got out there at some time during the day yesterday? You were there sometime during the day yesterday. All right, good. About 10 or 12 of you. How many of you plan on going today at some point in time? Let me see. Good, good. Those of you who haven't raised your hand either day, I hope you make a point. Go out for a couple of hours, all right? Between 2 and 5, even if you don't have kids, you would be blessed by what's going to happen in the kid zones, all right? And people are worried about how loud it is. Trust me, outdoors, it is not that loud. You can always back away, all right? You get a little farther away, the noise is not bad at all. We were there for the concert last night where we were. Sound was terrific. But they have about 3 or 4 different events for kids going on from 2 to 5 o'clock. If you want to see some death-defying acts on some BMX bikes, all right, pretty awesome, some of the things that they've done. We tried to have a video that showed a little bit of that, and I've been informed it's not working properly, all right? It was just done on an iPhone last night, and so we can't get it up and running today. But there were several hundred young people who gave their life to Christ during the events between 2 and 5 yesterday. It's exciting stuff. It's hard for me to guess what attendance is outdoors when it's big, wide, and open. Put me in any size church building and give me about 2 minutes and I can get it figured out pretty quick. But it's a little hard outdoors. I am going to say from 5 to 6, there were probably about 2,500 people there. And then from 6 o'clock till the conclusion, it probably got closer to 4 to 5,000, all right, showed up last night. So pretty powerful. Matt Redman. If you guys listen to Love, K-Love, You probably know who Matt Redman is, all right? Here in church, we've sung 10,000 Reasons. Okay, that's just one. Some of you might know some others. He's written a whole bunch, all right? What I didn't know about him were two things. One, I didn't know he's British. When he talks, he sounds just like Mark Addis, okay? So he's British. Number two, found this fascinating. Matt Redman gave his life to Jesus Christ at 10 years of age in London, England, at a Luis Palau crusade. That's why they brought him in here, all right? And he shared that story briefly last night. So Luis Palau is his spiritual father, and he talked about that last night. So they had Lecrae there. He was pretty good. They had that guy with a funky hairdo. What's his name? Lincoln Brewster. Yeah, big mohawk, all right? But anyway, all of it was terrific, and just great stuff going on. Some of you have read the email I sent to you yesterday as a last-minute encouragement. The chief of police of Reedley, last Saturday at the Reedley event, gave his life to Jesus Christ. That's worth applauding over. At the business luncheon this week, a Hindu priest came with another pastor and gave his life to Jesus Christ. And that is just absolutely awesome. One of the head guys, all right, in the Hindu community here in Fresno, Clovis area. And that's just absolutely, absolutely exciting. He's agreed to go through a discipleship program with one of the Fresno pastors. So exciting things are taking place. And I'm so grateful that Palau has come. Andrew spoke last night. Tonight, Luis will be speaking. Here's a recommendation for some of you who can't spend a lot of time, all right? Either time-wise you don't have it or energy-wise you don't have it. I would recommend showing up about 6 o'clock. You're going to get about 30 to 40 minutes of music, and then you're going to hear the first of two messages. All right, bring lawn chairs. There's plenty. It's easy, really, to get in there. The parking is not bad at all. And you walk in. Pick a distance that the volume sounds good for you. All right, you want to get up close? Great. You want to stay back a ways? Not a problem. All right, come casual. It's going to be a very pleasant day. 79 or 80 is the high. As soon as the sun goes down, it's very, very comfortable to slightly chilly, all right? So if you come in the evening, I would say bring a light wrap or bring a light blanket with you. You can sit there and put it over you while you sit in the chair. But worth the experience, and continue to pray for the adventure of today and what God is doing. I would say probably from last weekend to today, probably over 2,500 people have invited Christ in their life at all the various activities. And it's not over, and that's pretty thrilling. That's pretty thrilling. Here's the deal. As you know, I was involved in this financially. We got involved at the earliest possible moment. There aren't many people that God has gifted uniquely for world evangelism. The Billy Sundays, the Charles Haddon Spurgeons, the Billy Grahams, and the Luis Palaus are very few and far between. And so when we can have something like that come to our community, and we as the kingdom of God, not New Harvest Church and New Covenant Church and New Hope Church doing things on their own, but when the kingdom of God, when the church of the Central Valley, no names, just the fact that we are part of God's family, can join together and make a difference, and other people come to know Christ that may have never darkened the door of a church, but would go to an event outdoors like this, I want to be part of that. I want to be part of that. And so we have been engaged, and we've been engaged with the church financially. I haven't pressed y'all for an offering. That was part of our missions giving last year, all right? So today, as the email said yesterday, I'm pressing a little bit for an offering. As of yesterday, at the beginning of Friday morning, we were about $112,000 behind budget, okay? By the end of yesterday, it had been reduced to about $44,000, all right? And so I would like for all that to be taken care of by the end of today, by tomorrow, all right, as the churches respond. Because you see, we're responsible. I want the testimony in this community with all the businesses that we have done business with to make all this happen. And it's a lot, man. This stage is the best I've ever seen at a Christ-centered event ever. They did it right. We didn't settle for less. It was done right. And so that's why the sound is good and the visuals are good there. And so I want all those debts paid. And we're part of God's kingdom. New Hope doesn't need one bit of credit. But God's kingdom needs to be honored. And we made these commitments 20 months ago. Let's make sure that we keep them. And so whether you can participate with your personal attendance or not, I would love for you to participate, whether it's $5, $50, or $500, to see that this is done. Last service, I did two offerings. I think I've talked about this quick enough tonight that we'll do this all in one offering. So here's the deal. If you would like to help us take care of this, put that contribution in an envelope and write on that envelope, Palau. All right? If you wrote a check, make the check to New Hope, but on the envelope that's in the pew, write Palau. All right? That will make it easier for our counters tomorrow to process this. Please do me a favor. Don't write one check for tithes and Palau. That makes it really hard for the counters. All right? So now, if you only brought one check, okay, do it. but it's just much easier for our counters if they don't have to separate, all right, those amounts. So just write on the envelope, pull out, drop it in our offering when it comes by in a few minutes, and you'll have time to process that as I highlight a few other announcements. Our senior luncheon, which is the second Tuesday of every month for those 55 and older, Al Ghul, the saddle maker, since it's rodeo month, he's going to come talk about what he does, how he got started, and show you some examples of what he's done. And most of you have seen the Bible covers that he does, all right? He just does exquisite hand work. He has done saddles for rodeos that sell for $250,000. That is hard for me to imagine, but he is that good. So you'll want to come out and be part of that. Save the date, Wednesday, April 12th. That's during Easter break, or as the educational system calls it, spring break. But it's during that week, so we're going to have a family time together bowling, and Mark will get more information about that by next Sunday. But put that date on your calendar. I believe it's going to be held at Fresno State Student Union Bowling Alley, all right? And we're going to have it reserved for us that night. We're going to have a baptism on April the 23rd. We've got about 16 to 18 folks who are going to be baptized in our 9:15 and 10:45 services. If you have recently received Christ and you've never been baptized, fill out one of the communication cards and indicate that, and we can still get you in on April the 23rd. We'd be excited to do that. Let's see here, some prayer requests. Steve, Shelley told me that you got an update on Donnie, our junior high kid who's had some health issues.
Yeah, Donnie had a serious nose bleed yesterday. They had to take him back to Children's. They were going to infuse him with more platelets, but decided that was just going to bump it up for a while and come back down. He started some kind of chemo yesterday.
Okay. Okay, all right, so please be remembered, Donnie. He's in junior high and usually sits right up here in the first two rows, all right? He's always front and center, so please be praying for him. Jordan, Paul's Graf, part of our high school team. She's a sophomore in high school, and she's had three surgeries already here in the Fresno area for a mass that was on her rib. Second opinion in Stanford, and they said one surgery, and by summer, we think we'll have you up to full fitness. And so that surgery is tomorrow morning. So please be praying for them as they travel. She'll be there for a couple of days in recovery afterwards. So a couple of us, after Palau ends tonight, we're going to head up to Stanford so we can be there and have prayer with her in the morning and see her when she comes out of recovery and wish her and pray for her very best. Shelly Parker was supposed to be singing in the worship team this morning, but she is not well. So please remember to pray for Shelly. And who's that new face I saw on the worship team up there today? That is Laura Lee Brown, all right? Steve Brown's wife, all right? So thanks, Laura Lee, for being up there. Skip Humphreys, Jennifer Hernandez, part of our 10:45 service. This is her brother. He's been in a coma, not responsive, so I want you to be remembering to pray for him. And this past Friday, we just had an incredible time as we paid tribute and honor and celebrated the life of Polly Good, who went home to be with the Lord the previous week. And I got to tell you, as a pastor, I couldn't have been more proud. I was extremely proud of Polly and her approach to her cancer, her approach to her hospice care, her attitude right up to the very end was that of great joy. If you would have seen Kelly get up and pay tribute to her mom with a huge smile on her face, she had eight co-workers from the school where she teaches at came to support her that day. And here's one of the testimonies that I heard from one of her workers is, one of the reasons we're here is we want to find out what's going on with Kelly, because she has been so happy, we thought she was in denial. She said, we understand better today why Kelly is not as destroyed as we think she should have been. And what a wonderful testimony. That is what the Bible means. Be ready to give every person an answer for the hope that lives within you. And I told you guys in January that one of my goals for this year, that we talk and say enough things and do enough things so that all of us as a church family are better prepared to deal with our own death. Because that is a reality for every one of us. And we don't always have to talk about death as if it is something horrible, whether it's to ourselves or to those that we love. Jesus Christ is the victor over death and dying. And Paul tells us there are two great choices ahead of me, to live and to die. And he said, dying is better than living. We'll trust God for what that timing is. And Pauly, great, great example of the full confidence of Christ in that process. So what a great day we had there. Oh, sign-up sheets going around. If you want to go on a motorcycle run, April the 29th. That's a Saturday, heading over to Moss Landing to a great fish restaurant. And if you'd like to be part of that motorcycle ride, please sign up. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come, please, and join with me as we pray. Our Father, I love you. I thank you so very much for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for what you've been doing in the hearts and lives of people this week. Thank you for what you're going to do yet today. And then, Father, when today is over, then the hundreds and thousands of people who've invited Jesus Christ in their life, a card will have been filled out, and it will be given to a church either that is close to where they live or is the church of the friend who brought them to the event. And then, Father, the follow-up, bringing them into your family, is so very important. We call it discipleship. And so we pray that we as churches will do our part after this weekend is over to grow up the new babies in your family. Thank you for the privilege of being a part of, for the joy of giving and sharing today, Father. We say thanks for the events of last weekend here in this very room with our pie auction and preparation for our kids heading to Mexico. We say thank you. And for what you want to do in our midst today, we trust you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Before anybody moves, okay, let me say this because I forgot. Last Sunday night, the pie auction. Thank you to all of you who participated with what you brought and with what you spent. I really did not expect, nor was I pushing, to try to beat last year's goal. And I think we did. We took in over $21,000, all right, last Sunday evening. For those of you who are new or weren't here, we've got over 40 high school kids and about 15 to 20 adults heading to Mexico during Easter break. We'll be engaged. I don't know if we have that picture. It's too late. We got a picture of what the end result is going to be. But this year is phase two of that orphanage. Last year was phase one. We'll be working on another part of it. That's about a five-year project that we've chosen to invest in over the next 5 years. And so what you did last Sunday night is going to help us take care of phase two, and we hope in 5 years to show you not a rendering but the finished product picture. So God bless you. Thank you very much. How's your heart? And I think it's an important question for us as a church to ask ourselves, for those of us who say we're part of God's family. Am I still who I used to be? Major Thomas, you guys hear me refer to him on several occasions, probably the best Bible teacher I ever sat under my entire life. He's now in heaven. Also spoke with an English accent. The fact that he was born in London probably attributes to that. But Major Thomas made the statement, he said, often we use the name of Christian when really we haven't been changed. We're just housebroken pets. We've just learned how to clean up our behavior. We're potty trained. But you leave a dog in a house too long, what's he going to do? He's going to do what every dog does. He's just been housebroken. This song says, when we really enter into a relationship with God, there is a change that is going to happen. We've been looking at the reality of Jeremiah chapter 17, 9. Any of you remember what Jeremiah 17, 9 says? The heart is deceitful above what? And it is desperately wicked, or as the English Standard Version says, it is desperately sick. Who can find a cure? Who can understand it? That's the reason, folks, we need to be changed. It's because we are desperately wicked. Many of us have just overcome that problem by being housebroken, house trained. We've learned how to behave, but we've not dealt with the root cause of who we are at the heart of our life. The heart, as we've been talking about it for the last 5 weeks, this will be week number six today, that invisible part of us, all right, that really kind of directs mind, emotion, and will. That's that invisible part of us that Jeremiah said is desperately wicked. It is that part of us that Ezekiel said, God wants to give us a new heart. It's not a heart transplant of this muscle that makes blood flow through our body, but it's the part of us that falls in love. It's that part of us that when somebody walks in a room, we get angry. It's the part of us that makes us behave badly. And so what we've been looking at over the last 2 weeks are the four great enemies of this invisible heart. Just as our physical heart has enemies, things like cholesterol and high blood pressure, and we look for ways to mitigate the consequences of those things, so in this invisible heart of ours, there are some natural enemies. And over the past 2 weeks, we identified the four key culprits, not the only ones, but the four key ones, and they were, do you remember what the first one was? Guilt. And what does guilt say? I owe you, all right? In other words, we know we have offended someone and we're guilty about it, whether it's your spouse, whether it's your child, whether it's a guy you work with or your boss, most importantly, God. And so we have this great sense that says, I owe you. And guilt makes us feel condemned, and it clogs our spiritual heart arteries. Do you remember what the second word was? The first enemy was guilt. The second enemy is anger. As guilt says, I owe you, anger says what? You owe me. You've made me mad. You've done me wrong. You owe me. Third enemy that we looked at last week, greed. What does greed say? I owe me. I deserve more. I deserve a bigger car. I deserve a nicer house. I deserve a vacation. And can you ever satisfy the hunger of greed? No, you cannot. And then last week we looked at the fourth enemy of the heart, which is jealousy. And we boiled that down after looking at it pretty closely. And jealousy says what? God, you owe me. You've given to so-and-so, why didn't you give to me? God, you provided for so-and-so, why didn't you do the same thing for me? I don't know if in the last 2 weeks you recognized any symptoms in your own life. Hopefully not. But I'm guessing you saw some of yourself in there. As they always say, seeing the problem is half the solution. That is the easy half, I will admit. The question now is, what are we going to do about it? Or worse yet, what are we going to do about them? Because more than likely, we saw some reflections of more than one of these enemies in our own heart. Do we ignore the enemies that are attacking our heart like so many of us do with our cholesterol and with high blood pressure? Or do we really look for a cure, a solution, a remedy? So let me ask you the question we've been asking for 6 weeks. How's your heart? I'm not asking you to define for me how's your spouse's heart or how's your kid's heart. I'm asking you, how's your heart? As we begin this search, I want to challenge you not to practice creative bookkeeping like we often do at tax time. The kind of tricks that we play to hide debt and make things look better than they really are. Who do you owe? Causing you to carry guilt or anger or greed or jealousy. Who do you think owes you? Are you ready to pay? Are you ready to receive payment? Are you ready to cancel a debt? Whatever's necessary so you can have a happy, healthy heart. Remember, just as Jeremiah said, we have a heart that is desperately sick and wicked. Ezekiel said that God said, I want to give you a new heart and I want to put a new spirit in you. I'll remove your heart of stone and I'll replace it with a soft, supple heart. I'll put my spirit in you. John Wellwood, who is a pretty well-known author and he's a clinical psychologist, wrote a book called The Changing Heart. And in it, he makes this statement. He said, the most powerful agent of growth and transformation is something much more basic than any technique. It's a change of heart. John Wellwood is simply saying the same thing Ezekiel said thousands of years ago. God wants to change our heart. You see, in order for us to move out of a heart that is clogged and troubled, we need to create some new habits. What we may call the habits of joy, the habits of happiness, the habits of contentment, but we need some new habits. Let me dispel a commonly held myth about change, changing of our hearts. I'm not sure how this got started, but many Christians have embraced this approach to life change, which at the end of the day leaves many of us wondering if God really has any interest in changing anything at all, much less our hearts. Let me use a kind of a made-up story, though it's very close to reality. It's just kind of a composite of lots of circumstances. I chose the name to use today, Jerry. Jerry Brown is probably the guy I know who's had more heart trouble with a physical heart than anybody else I've ever known. More than a dozen, 14 stents, plus explored 15 stents now, all right, and other major heart surgeries. And so, Jerry, this is an honor. Today, good or bad, I think we can all relate to some things here. Let's check in with Jerry. Jerry's been having trouble going to sleep at night. That ever happened to you, Jerry? Okay. You suffer sometimes from acid reflux. Lately, you've noticed that just walking up a single flight of stairs leaves you breathing harder than normal. Ever experienced that? Okay. All right. That meant, oh, yes. So Jerry makes an appointment to go see his cardiologist. Things don't seem to be right. So the doctor runs Jerry through an extensive battery of tests, including that grueling 3 minutes on a treadmill. A week later, Jerry finds himself in the good doctor's exam room waiting for results. The look on the doctor's face confirms Jerry's suspicions. Something's not quite right. The doctor glances gravely at the chart, and he says, Jerry, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the worst-case scenario, right now you're about a 7. Surgery at this moment is probably not what we should do, but it will be if you don't make some immediate changes in your life. Well, like what? Jerry asks, a bit worried about what's coming next. The doctor pulls a single page from his clipboard and he hands it to Jerry. He said, Jerry, this is a 3-day-a-week exercise regimen. Once your body becomes accustomed to this level of activity, we're going to bump it up a notch. Has he ever done anything like that to you? Okay, all right. So this is pretty accurate, right? All right. Okay, including right now. But Jerry complains, Doc, I don't think you understand. I can't do this. I got a bad heart. You said so yourself. Now, Doc, once my heart gets stronger, then yeah, I won't mind exercising a little, but you can't expect me to do this stuff in my present condition. The doctor looks confused, so Jerry continues. Look, this says you want me to walk for 30 minutes 3 times a week. Do you realize how winded I'll be? I'll be sweating like a pig. If I do those stretches, I will be unbearably sore for days, Doc. I got a bad heart. I can't do this stuff. Look, first fix my heart, then I'll consider the routine. Jerry, I'm trying to fix your heart. And this is how to fix it, by exercising it. The discomfort is part of the cure. You strengthen a muscle by exhausting it and then letting it rest. To fix your heart, we've got to exhaust it periodically, let it rest. And yes, you will sweat. And yes, you will be sore. And you won't always feel too good during the process. But this is the road to recovery. Jerry shakes his head. Look, Doc, let me level with you. My wife has been trying to get me to exercise for years. Does this sound about right, Sonny? So about a year ago, I finally gave in and I tried out her treadmill. I wasn't on that thing 5 minutes before I thought I was going to die. I'm telling you, Doc, it won't work. I've already tried exercise. It made me tired. And there's another thing. Do you know how silly I look in spandex shorts? It's kind of like I'm wearing hippo pantyhose. Now, once I lose a little weight, I may go for this fitness look, but not until then. So if you'll please do something to strengthen my heart, then I'll be happy to follow your advice. After all, doc, you're the expert, not me. At this point, the doctor opens the door and says, Jerry, you're an idiot. Now, remember, we made this story up. I guess doctors really don't say things like, you're an idiot. But I'm sure they would like to from time to time. And in this particular made-up scenario, the doctor would be right. We don't wait until our heart is healthy to exercise. We exercise to get and then keep our heart in shape. And this is true of our invisible heart as well. Yet many of us try to use Jerry's same line of reasoning with God, and consequently, we get the same results. You see, in churches all over the world, I thought about calling Milo and having him sing this song today, because we've sung it here many times. But we stand up in church and we sing, change my heart, O God, make it ever new. Change my heart, O God, let me be like you. And I wish it were that easy. I wished a changed heart was as simple as singing a song or praying a prayer. And sometimes it is, but in most cases, it's not. And here's why. A change of heart requires conscious choice and willing effort. And sometimes those two things bring pain. There's always some discomfort involved. Catch this. Did it hurt to admit that you have a wicked heart? I don't mean 20 years after you discovered it. I meant when you first discovered it. Was it painful to say, I'm a sinner? You see, as I got past my little kid years, and I got a little older, I wanted to say, man, God, I'm a third generation preacher's kid. I've been to church all my life. That's not really me. Yeah, it is. Changed hearts, the result of forming some new habits, some new exercises of the heart. For that reason, most of us would rather sing about it than do the work. Like Jerry, we want a miracle cure, a quick fix. That's Jerry in the story, not this Jerry. But we can't expect to break bad habits overnight. We've spent years behaving ourselves into those habits. Somebody very smart one time said it takes a habit to break a habit. We can pray every day for a generous heart, but until we start exercising our heart with generosity, guess what? Nothing's going to change. That's like praying, Lord, give me a smaller appetite so that I'll eat less. Well, if you want to shrink your appetite, you got to embark on some appetite-shrinking exercises. We need new habits. Now, some of us, as we've talked about a bit over the last few weeks, get away with not changing by saying, that's just the way I am. That's why this song today I thought was so powerful. Change. I'm not who I used to be. Old habits die hard. Some people don't want to turn loose of guilt. It's like a comforter or a quilt. It's your favorite. Some do the same thing with anger and greed and jealousy. All are habit forming. And like any habit that goes unchecked over time, those things begin to define us. These disorders become such a part of us that we no longer view them as issues to be resolved. Instead, we dismiss their destructive habit as characteristics that are hardwired into our personality. That's why we say things like, that's just the way I am. I tell it like it is. Quite frankly, folks, that's an excuse to be rude. And you like being rude. Sometimes we say, the men of my family are famous for their tempers. That's an excuse just for you to blow up, be angry, and expect people to go along with it. What can I say? I'm just an emotional girl. That's an excuse to have outbursts that are unreasonable. Hey, I'm a saver, and I squeak when I walk. That's just an excuse to be a tightwad. Ralph, another story. Ralph was grossly overweight. When the subject of weight came up, he would smile and say, hey, I just enjoy eating. Me too. It's why I've lost the same 15 pounds the last 4 years. Okay? It's the reason this is an extra large shirt instead of my traditional large shirts. Okay? Why? I love eating. That was Ralph's excuse. He'd used the line for so long, he believed it. And from his perspective, he wasn't fat because he lacked self-control. He was simply born with a greater propensity for culinary delectation. How do you like that word, Ray Steele? I looked up a word I could use like that one, man. I do because I cut and pasted it. And then I went to sound, all right, to make sure I pronounced it right, all right? And we just think that we have this better palate than anybody else does, so it's my excuse for eating more. His size had nothing to do with habits that needed to be changed, was his thinking. But two heart attacks and a couple of bypasses later, Ralph dropped the charade and he faced reality. It was time for him to eliminate some life-threatening habits and embrace a different approach to food and exercise. I would suggest to you there's a little bit of Ralph in all of us. I know when Shelley tells me and it's 10 o'clock at night and I'm heading for the freezer for an ice cream. She says, I thought you wanted to lose 5 pounds. I do, tomorrow. Okay. It's my grandmother McLean's fault. She loved ice cream. Okay. We like to laugh off bad habits as personality traits, but that, folks, does not change the truth. These are habits and they are destructive, and in our heart they need to be broken. And so we pray for change while we make excuses for the very things that need to change. Let me say that one again. We pray for change while we make excuses for the very things that need to change. We want to wake up one morning with a generous spirit. We want to wake up guilt-free. We want to wake up and we're not anger-ridden anymore. But when it comes time to do the heavy lifting, to do those habit-breaking exercises necessary to bring that change, something in us resists. Could it be that wicked heart? If God wants to change me overnight, fine. But if you're asking me to be involved in the process, then maybe you're trying to make me somebody I'm not. Over the next couple of weeks, we're going to look at 4 specific spiritual exercises and practices that if we will make them a habit, they will effectively neutralize the enemies of our heart, all 4 of them. Like physical exercise, implementing this regimen, it's often a matter of discipline, an act of our will, a feeling-defying act of the will. A feeling-defying act of the will. I want to feel the ice cream on the palate of my mouth. I've got to make a choice. Like physical exercise, these internal stretches are always profitable, even when they're not particularly enjoyable. The longer we've been living with guilt, the longer we've been hanging on to our anger, the longer we're clinging to the stuff that we try to control and own and buy, the longer we compare ourselves to what others have, the harder it will be to exercise. The longer we've neglected our heart, the harder it is to get it into shape. But in the end, I think I can promise you this, it will be worth every effort. I've never yet met a physically fit person who regretted doing the hard work necessary to get in shape. I've never met anyone who regretted a good habit, but we all know people who are paying the price for bad habits they've never ever kicked. In fact, you probably know people who consistently practice the 4 habits that we are going to talk about in these next 2 weeks. You may have never actually seen them engage in those habits, but there's something about their lives that tips us off to the healthy condition of their hearts. Simply put, they're joyful, they're genuinely happy, and they're a joy to be around in all kinds of circumstances. You see, happiness, joy, is a habit. I think all of us enter the world in the 21st century on a happiness quest. We're all looking for it. Now, I'll be honest, as a pastor, I would love to believe that people are looking for truth. But I think Sunday morning attendance around the world tells us they're looking for happiness more than truth. We all want happiness. Most of us think we can squeeze it out of somebody or something, but it never works, especially for the person who we're squeezing. Ask around, and you'll discover that the happiest people you know are people who have mastered these four habits. Whereas these are learned behaviors, happy people seem to do them instinctively. We tend to think, surely she's always been gracious. Oh, he's always been kind and humble. But quite frankly, that's rarely the story. Over time, these habits have helped to shape this person's character and their relationship patterns, often because he or she grew up in an environment where these habits were taught or modeled. We're tempted to think that happiness is simply a matter of disposition, or it is the result or product of good circumstances. But think through that a minute. You know people who are in a less than enviable circumstance than you are, and they are genuinely happy. On the other hand, we know people with more stuff than we have, and they're not content with what they have. Why? I suggest to you today, happiness and joy is not synonymous with wealth and stuff. As I look back, I think one of the happiest people I've ever known in my life was a man by the name of Sam Lumpkin. Now, with a name like that, you'd think he'd never be happy. Lumpkin, okay? It's just a wonderful family. Sam was an old man when I was a kid. You've heard me tell stories about the guy who could pray in church. When Dad called on Sam Lumpkin to pray, you had two emotions at the same time. Oh, good, and oh, no. Okay? And oh, good, because nobody could seem to pull the presence of God in a visible way into a room like Sam Lumpkin could. Dad would call on Sam Lumpkin, and he would get out of the pew, and he would hit his knees, and he would bow in front of his pew. His pew became his altar. And Sam Lumpkin would pray. And pray. And pray. And you wondered if the amen was ever coming. Sam Lumpkin, by no means, had the world's wealth. Sam Lumpkin had a large family. I don't think Sam Lumpkin had a third grade education. Sam and Effie Lumpkin's youngest child was born severely, severely physically and mentally retarded. To use the current vernacular would be so inappropriate for describing their youngest child. As bad as I've ever seen, and there still be life. Sam and Effie could not come to church together because one of them at all times had to be with him. He lived into his late 20s. Constant care. Here is a couple who had virtually nothing. Troubles beyond what most of us would ever experience. And Sam and Effie Lumpkin always, always were happy. Okay, let me introduce to you the first habit. Here's the first one. This is the one we use primarily to confront guilt. You see, secrets lose their power when we expose them to light. And the light that exposes our secrets and that frees our heart from the oppressive power of guilt is confession. Confession to God and to others as well. I'm not talking about the kind of confession that most of us are accustomed to in life. That simple admission of culpability to a particular incident. Yes, Mom, I knocked the vase off the table. Yes, honey, I drank milk out of the carton at the refrigerator door. Yes, officer, I did notice that light was red. You see, that kind of confession eases our conscience temporarily, and quite frankly, we think if we get ahead of the problem, we'll have less problems. It's not that we were genuinely sorry or that we planned to change. Honey, I'm sorry. Yes, I drank out of the carton. Are you going to stop drinking out of the carton? No, we're not. I just should tell you, you should probably make sure it's a new carton at our house if we serve you milk, okay? I'm just saying. See, it's the secrets that keep our heart in turmoil. Worse, this kind of Sissy confession actually fuels destructive behavior rather than curbs it. It leads to more secrets and greater guilt. Let me see if I can explain. Remember, some of you are new, let me just get this out of the way. This sermon series is not original with me. This comes out of the content of a book that I've been using for about 2 years in counseling. It's not original with Andy Stanley either. It's just original in the way in which he packaged it. And one of the fun things for me as I read the book was there's a lot of similarities that I share with Andy Stanley. Now, let me get out of the way. There are several things I do not share with Andy Stanley. Number one, Andy is young. I don't share that anymore. Number two, Andy is pretty good looking. I don't share that one. Number three, Andy pastors a very large church with multi-sites, and I don't share that either. What I do share is a very similar background. He's the son of a Baptist preacher. He started preaching when he was a teenager. He worked for his dad before he ever pastored his own church. So there's a lot of similarities. So the way in which we were raised, a lot of experiences that he writes about, I've been there, experienced that, done that. I think it's so cool. And this is one of those that he highlights that I said, right there. And that is one of the verses after John 3:16 and Psalm 23, one of the first verses that as kids growing up in church that we learned was 1 John. Yeah, I heard it. 1:9. 1 John 1:9. Those of you who know it, say it with me. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I learned that early on. I probably wasn't 10 years old before I learned that verse. And I thought when I got to be about 12 and I was quoting that verse, you know, I thought, whoa, baby, this verse is too good to be true. I mean, God forgives me. I move on. This is clearly a loophole. Over time, this verse became an escape hatch. Listen to this scenario. This is absolutely true. Many of you probably experienced it. Every night before I'd go to sleep, I would have this detailed dialogue with God. God, I did this and this and this and this. I confessed all of my sins that I'd done that day. I would try to remember every one of them and say them out loud. Sometimes, on a few days, my list was really short. Far more frequently, it was longer. But either way, I was so careful to confess each and every one of them that I'd done wrong. Why? Because 1 John 1:9, if I confess my sins, plural, he's faithful and just to forgive me and wipe it off my slate. And then I got a little more proficient at this prayer, and just to be safe, I would say, and God, forgive anything I might have overlooked in this prayer. And as I got more theological, I would say, Lord, forgive me of my sins of commission and omission. See, commission is the things I commit, and omission are the things I didn't do that I should have done. So I got all my bases covered. And I would go to sleep knowing my sin bucket was empty. But in the back of my head, I knew that probably I would fill that bucket up with the same stuff the next day. I was counting on God to keep his end of the deal. But you see, that's not where the trend ended. The trend got more dangerous. When tempted to sin, not now after I sinned, but when I was tempted to sin, I could reason myself into giving in to temptation. I could say, oh, this is wrong, but if I go through with it, I can always confess it tonight and God will forgive me. Everything will be fine. And before long, listen to this, our confession habit is supporting our sin habit. Do you get that? Our confession habit. Hey, it's okay because God's going to forgive me anyway. And so we continue with our sin habit. I think that's called self-codependency. Okay? Eric, does that work? Does that make sense? Yeah, I know. I just came up with it. All right? It's quite a system. It's also quite a loophole. As a boy, raised Baptist, I was shocked when I discovered that my Catholic friends had a very similar system. It just had a little twist to it. The way they described it, now keep in mind, we were all early teens about this time. The way they described it is that they could do whatever they wanted to till Friday, and then they would run into confession. They would lay all their dirty laundry out to a priest, and they would go on their merry way, and I remember thinking, do they think God's an idiot? My Catholic friends have to see their hypocrisy. hypocrisy. I mean, in my mind, they were handling confession way different than I was. But the truth is, there was absolutely no difference. We were using a loophole. You see, here's the problem. We weren't confessing as a step towards change. We were confessing to relieve pain. See, confession for many of us is all about guilt relief. I knew even as I was confessing that I might be back here the very next day confessing the same sin. My routine had nothing to do with change. I just wanted to feel better, kind of like taking Tums. I go ahead and eat the things that I know every time I eat them give me indigestion, but I just pop a couple of Tums. Chances are you play your own version of that confession game. Some confess to a priest, some directly to God, but none of us really interested in changing things. But we sure feel better about ourselves, and the cloud lifts and the slate seems to be clean, and now that we've gotten God off our case, we think maybe we have him on our side. Let me ask you this. If you were God, let me ask you this. Even if you're not God, would you side up with somebody who treated you that way? Imagine you had a brother who continually stole from you, regularly embarrassed you in public, talked badly about you behind your back, but once a week he came to you and said in very general terms, "Hey, I'm sorry for what I did this week." Now you already knew how sorry your brother was, but no sooner did you turn around and your brother was right back to his old tricks. To make matters worse, he has the nerve to ask for your help whenever he gets in a bind. How would you characterize that kind of relationship? Even if you were able to genuinely forgive him each and every time, what would eventually happen to this relationship? I would suggest to you that eventually would be no relationship at all. At best, you would feel used. More than likely, you would feel insulted. What kind of idiot does my brother take me for? Does he really think that I believe his apology is sincere when he turns around and does the same thing again and again? Manipulation, do you think? Do I need to make the application for you, or can you bridge that gap all on your own? Isn't that the way we often treat God? Let's face it, our approach to confession, I think, is often an insult to our Heavenly Father. We certainly wouldn't dream of staying in a relationship with someone who treated us this way, and it's a good thing that God's love is unconditional, otherwise we'd all be in trouble. So where did we go wrong? Why this endless cycle? Why is it that we've allowed confession to become a tool that facilitates our sin rather than ending it? Well, I'm kind of glad you asked that. Or I'm glad I asked it for you. Anyway, it's a great question, and it deserves our thoughtfulness. You see, we play the confession game because somewhere along the way, we were taught that the purpose of confession was conscience relief. That is, we confess in order to make us feel better for what we've done. If you want to put a theological spin on it, we confess because we think it will somehow help God feel better about what we've done. According to our twisted way of thinking, confession puts everything back just the way it was before we did whatever it was that we did that makes us feel like we need to confess. But come on, does that really make sense? How can confessing to God what you did to another person make everything right? How does that restore anything? What about the person you've wronged? Not only does it not make sense, but it doesn't work. The pseudo-confession doesn't remove our guilt like Tylenol. Our quick confession prayers take the edge off the pain, but they don't heal the problem that caused our sin. That's why we find ourselves repeating and confessing the same sins of the past over and over again, and the guilt is still with us. Let me wrap this up. The purpose of confession is ultimately to change our life and behavior. The early Catholic literature on penance and confession supported this broadened definition. You see, in the early days of Catholicism, you were not allowed to confess the same sins to the priest over and over. In their original rules, you only got to confess a sin once. And then the priest gave you penance so severe that you never wanted to do it again. Now, Catholic Church has found a lot more grace in the last few decades. They let you say the same thing again, and the penance isn't near as steep. You see, penance comes from repentance. And repentance means, I'm going to change direction. And the Catholic Church, at a period of time in their history, made it so painful to keep going in the direction you were going that you never wanted to go there again. Thank goodness God took all the penance at the cross for us. That's grace. But that doesn't mean we can treat His grace cheaply, shabbily. Repentance is often pictured as a person walking one way and turning to the other. In Scripture, confession is clearly connected with restitution and repentance and restoration. And next week, we're going to look at a couple of examples of all of that. Let me give you one Old Testament passage of how this got started in Numbers chapter 5. Moses wrote these words, "Any man or woman who wrongs another in any way and is unfaithful to the Lord is guilty, must confess the sin they have committed. They must make full restitution for the wrong they have done, add a fifth of the value to it, and give it all to the person they have wronged." See, for the Jew, this wasn't about feeling better about yourself. It was about making things right with the one you've sinned against with interest. It wasn't enough to be sorry. God is interested in real change. I think I've made an error the last 20 years of my preaching. I don't know that it's a grievous error. But you see, I grew up in a culture, and it wasn't a bad culture, but I grew up in a culture in church to where every church service I went to, an altar call was given. Every service. Five people may have only showed up for prayer meeting. We probably had an altar call. And they were all members of the same family. We had an altar call. And so I got to a point to where I guess I didn't want to embarrass anybody. I wanted to make it easier. I want folks to understand that it's not about works. It's about a faith choice. And so the vast majority of the time, I say if you're ready to invite Christ in your life, you can do it sitting right where you are, and you can. You can do it in the privacy of your home, the privacy of your car, the quietness of your pew. And I think that's still okay. But I think I've also shortchanged folks a bit by not having a public declaration of this moment of repentance and change. As we'll look at next week, we will see some of the things in the first century church that were much more drastic than what I'm talking about. I think I was also motivated, every time I go to prison, it's not raise your hand with everybody's heads bowed or eye closed. We ask men and women behind prison walls, if you're serious about inviting Jesus Christ into your life, step forward. Be bold. Let the rest of this prison yard know that you're going to be a different man, a different woman from this moment on. Why do I do that with inmates and I don't do that here? You see, here's what I think is important about the public confession of our faith. Is if I step forward and I tell you I'm on a diet and you see me at 31 flavors, you have every right to say, "Tim, what about that diet?" If I stand in front of a congregation and say, "I've given my life to Jesus Christ," and then I see you going into the same old haunts, doing the same old things that you've always done, don't I now have the right and the privilege of saying, "Oh, you made a new profession to faith in Christ. Is there a change?" And this is not about you and I being fruit examiners, but there is a point of accountability that comes. I want to wrap with this, and I know I'm going to be a few minutes late. What's new? I looked up, though I've quoted them, I've not quoted them, I've read them several times off the screen, on the occasions when I have participated in our Thursday night ministry called Celebrate Recovery. And their principles that they use every single week are principles that you and I should use every single day. Listen, I'm not going to go through all 12. I'm going to hit the few highlights. Number one, we admit we are powerless over our addictions and compulsive behaviors, that our lives have become unmanageable. I know that nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature. Does that not sound like Jeremiah 17:9? My heart is desperately wicked. They use Romans 7:18, for I have a desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. The second recovery step, we come to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Philippians 2:1, for it is God who works in you to will and act according to his good purpose. Number three, we made a decision to turn our lives and our wills over to the care of God. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, for that is your spiritual act of worship. We made a decision to turn our lives over. Change. Four, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Five, we admitted to God, listen to this, to ourselves and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. Is that not accountability? Eric Olson, once you introduce somebody to come up on stage at Celebrate Recovery to give a testimony, what is the traditional greeting? Okay, you state out loud in front of the group, my name is Tim Rowland, all right? I am a believer in Jesus Christ, and I have struggled with this addiction, this codependency issue, this issue of greed, anger, okay? You state it out loud in front of 20 to 50 to 100 people who are part of that group. So what have you done? You have made yourself accountable to all of those who were there to help you in your change, in staying in a direction that is different than where you had been going. We are entirely ready to have God remove all defects of character. We humbly ask him to remove all of our shortcomings. Eight, we made a list, listen to this, takes another step further. We made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. Nine, we made direct amends to such people whenever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. 10, I'm going to stop here. We continue. This is ongoing habits. We continue to take personal inventory, and when we are wrong, we promptly admit it. 1 Corinthians 10:12. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. You want to get rid of guilt? Then confess God's way. Confession is repentance that leads us in another direction. I don't know where you are in your walk with Christ. If you need to confess to him, I'm going to invite you to do so quietly in your pew right where you are today. Next Sunday, I'm giving an altar call. I'm setting you up in advance. I'm going to let you know. Won't catch you by surprise. If you made that decision today, no problem. I'll invite you to come down. If you made that decision 6 months ago, but you've really never told anybody about it, I'm going to ask you to come down. We talk about baptism being a public testimony of an inward change. That is true. Do you know how quickly John the Baptist baptized those who had repented? Immediately. They were standing right by the river when he preached. They invited Christ into life. He put them into water. And guess who was watching? Roman guards and centurions who were watching the crowds. They identified with the new king, and his name was Jesus. We want to get rid of the enemies of our heart. It starts with confession. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you for what you're reminding us of. Thank you for what we're allowing you to teach us. Thank you, Father, that you're giving us an opportunity to let the light of your scriptures shine brightly into our own hearts. We are not to look right or left at anyone else, but to allow your presence to reveal to us what you want to do in us. And when we let you do it in us, we are amazed at what you are willing to do for us. So, Father, help us with this journey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.